Everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel here on YouTube. Today we are going to talk about a company from the United States. You might have heard about it. I'm quite sure you heard about it. The company is called Intel. In the past few months, I have been speaking extensively about the sector of semiconductors or processors manufacturing. Also about the other major players in this sector, about ASML, TSMC, and about Samsung. I'm going to link the videos. Each company got a video so far, and there is also one about the sector. I'm going to link them in this presentation when I see fit, because I will bring them in the conversation also. But before we jump right in, I'm going to ask you to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my site. I do them quite regularly these days, on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sundays. You should expect new and hopefully interesting videos on my site. That being said, let's go directly to the presentation. So we are talking about Intel. I'm saying it's the underdog in processors manufacturing, meaning that from the three large manufacturing companies in the sector, TSMC and Samsung and Intel, let's say that Intel is seen by a large proportion of analysts and market interested and investors and so on and so forth as being the underdogs, and we will see exactly why. If you remember from the previous presentations, if not, I'm linking right now the one about ASML. ASML is a totally different company, meaning that ASML is the supplier of some very specialized and let's say very complex and also very valuable machines, which are required by all the processors or semiconductors manufacturers of all these three. Of course, there are some other competitors from China and so on and so forth, but let's say that the other ones are lagging far behind with the from technological point of view. So a bit of history. For a long period of time, I've seen that Intel was dominating the market in the semiconductors manufacturing. So around 37% of all the semiconductors or the processors manufactured around the world were coming from the United States, with Intel being the leading, having the leading role. Now they are on the third place. TSMC is the leader with, if I remember correctly, 57% market share, because they were overtaken recently by the Asian competitors, TSMC and Samsung. How was that possible? The other competitors, and especially TSMC, had a very good collaboration with ASML, and they got this new technology called EUV, extreme ultraviolet technology. And right now only Samsung and TSMC are manufacturing the, let's say, the best processors, which are considered to be the ones which are using this 5 nanometers technology. TSMC and Samsung benefited a lot from the collaboration with Dutch company, with this ASML, which is producing these lithography machines. But Intel has planned a comeback till 2025, so or so they say. And I think they should also, and they are also relying on the same company, ASML, that wants to introduce a new technology, which is called numerical aperture, so NA, extreme ultraviolet technology, EUV. And supplementary, of course, they are building several plants. The investments are evaluated at $44 billion, so quite significant investments. And they are done in, so of course, in the United States, where Intel originated, in Arizona, New Mexico, and Oregon, Costa Rica, Israel, and Ireland. And there is another one planned that was recently in the news, that somehow Italy managed to convince them to invest also in Italy, to build their foundry, as the, let's say that the plants which are producing the processors are called. Then I'm invested in Intel. I'm also invested in all the other three companies, in ASML, TSMC, and in Samsung. You might ask yourself, okay, if TSMC is the leader, if ASML is the monopolistical supplier for all of them, Samsung is on second place, why also invest in Intel? Because it's like the loser in this competition, or at least so it seems right now. Well, first of all, that there was this recent processors crisis, which is still with us, from what I understand. And I think the entire sector is a good investment, so you have little chances of going wrong if you invest in a company in this sector. Although being fabless means that they don't have foundries, proved to be more profitable, more efficient for companies like Apple, Qualcomm, or even Nvidia, advanced micro devices, or AMD as well. The recent events with this crisis in the processors market is shifting the value chain in favor of foundry owners. I read that TSMC was actually able to increase the prices with 20% for their processors. Then you have the, let's say, less related with the supply chain crisis and with the processors crisis and so on and so forth, which is currently still active. You have this fourth industrial revolution. You have the Internet of Things. You will see that Internet of Things is actually a segment at Intel, a separated segment, and all other technological developments, meaning that we are producing more and more electronical devices which need these processors, and it's a good argument to invest in this sector. So as a whole, another argument in favor of Intel specifically is that it was, let's say, the largest company and a very significant competitor a long time ago. It's still a significant competitor, so they somehow proven themselves, and I think they still have potential for a serious comeback. And even if they remain on the third place, or they go on the second place, or even on the first place, there are, let's say, little chances that they will not grow in terms of revenues, earnings, dividends, and so on and so forth in the future. And what was another argument for which I had like this kind of index fund strategy approach of buying into all these four companies was that I don't have a crystal ball, so I really cannot tell what will happen in the future, if Intel will overtake the other two companies or not, and so on and so forth, and what will be in 5 to 10 years. So we are looking on a longer term horizon, and that's why I'm saying that also the industry, so the sector perspectives are very, very good. Now, looking at the specific financial performance, so segments of the company, these are the financial reports from third quarter, so the quarter ended September 2021, from the investors relations, so official numbers from the company. On the left side, you have the revenue, which is okay. I didn't even wanted to present you the operating income per segment, but then I realized that this is a good opportunity to tell you about the, let's say, the my course about the okay, gross contribution, sales contributions. It depends, and in this case, I think they have gross. Yeah, so they have gross profits or gross margin. Because I'm recommending there, and I'm linking right now this video in my course, I'm recommending to avoid the allocation of anything that comes after the gross profit in the P&L on segments, or on some other views, or on segments in this case, on products, on regions, geographies, and so on and so forth, and you will see exactly why. So from revenue point of view, let's say that the quarter, third quarter, is better than the same quarter in 2020. Also accumulated the total revenue for the first 9 months of 2021. The revenues are better than the first 9 months of 2020. The gains come mainly from the client computing group, and also from the Internet of Things, just as I have mentioned. Lagging somehow behind is the data center group, and this is basically why the analysts are not so happy, because they don't understand how is this possible. Intel has explained that somehow let's say even if they were able to produce and to supply their processors when assembling equipments, if some other components are missing from maybe some other manufacturers, other types of components, then they are somehow also not making their sales. Now going to this operating income, why I don't like it, because in the operating income you get to allocate a lot of costs which are very difficult to allocate. And for example, if you are looking at the first 9 months, the operating income of all other, which is minus 4.4 billions, almost double, not exactly double, but quite significant compared with the first 9 months of the loss is almost doubled since 2020. If you are looking at the revenues, you see that somehow the revenues are also double, but with positive. But in the overall numbers, they are not so significant. So somehow this is the result of allocating things. And if you are starting to have operating income on each segment, you don't get that much relevant information. That's why I'm a fan of showing here, instead of the operating total operating income, only the gross profit in this case, or if they have a contribution, or so gross contribution or sales contribution, it depends how they split the cost between direct and indirect, or between fixed and variable. They seem to split them between direct and indirect. I think it's quite the standard. But it's that can give you more valuable information. You can see which products are actually bringing you more gross profit, and it's far more relevant than playing with some allocation and I don't know, allocating accounting on the level of segment based on I don't know what. You will have to have the company so well built that it's clear and so separated. The functions will have to be so separated between the segments that you are sure that somehow the, let's say that the numbers are reliable. From my point of view, if you come with with numbers like this, it's like there is no point in doing this allocation. But enough about the allocation. Then if you are talking about the P&L overall, so you see a gross profit improvement both in the quarter, within the third quarter, but also in the first 9 months. The operating expenses are increasing in the first 9 months and also in the quarter. Of course, they warned all the analysts and all the investors that this will continue to happen due to their expansion and their investments and so on and so forth, which I can understand. Let's say that the income before taxes is also in the quarter is better than the same quarter in 2020, but in the first 9 months it seems to be 1 billion lower. However, if we are looking at earnings per share, the earnings per share look better for the quarter, but also for the let's say for the 9 months, so year to date 9 months of 2021 compared with 2020. The reason is that they are doing a lot of shares buybacks, so it's normal that even in this case, it's not normal, but in this case, it seems that the share buybacks have helped them to deliver better earnings per share. Then, if we are talking about the financial performance and balance sheet, cash flow, and ratios, I didn't put here, they are presenting in much. So way too many details for my taste from the balance sheet and cash flow, so that I can put it in this presentation. However, I have some key numbers. First of all, I was surprised about the fact that they have 22.8 billions in the balance sheet in trading assets, mainly because it's not their core business. Their current CEO says that the actual situation of the company is due to the fact that they haven't invested enough in the past. I would say that they have invested enough, but in the wrong kind of assets. They need to invest in foundries and in research and development and in things like this, and not in trading assets. So for me, it was quite shocking to find out that they are dealing, and that's a significant number. And it kind of reminds me of the decision that Tesla took to invest in Bitcoin, but let's say that Tesla doesn't interest me so much because their fundamental business is not interesting for me. So the fact that they are adding in their assets Bitcoin or any other cryptocurrency is, let's say, secondary. It's very relevant because I'm invested in this company and I do not understand why they are doing this. If you have more information, maybe you can drop a comment below. Then they have 63.6 billion in retained earnings, although they have, just as I have said, they are doing a lot of share buybacks, which is very good for the shareholders. They have the money, from my point of view, if they redirect the trading assets, and they should have enough money to invest in, so to have this 44 billion investment in factories, potentially also without taking more debt. Then if you are looking at the stockholders' equity, 90 billion, total assets 116, so they are quite close, actually a little bit better than this ratio of 1:1 equity to debt. So 90 billions will be 180, double, so it's quite okay. They have some debt, but no, nothing spectacular. Then if you are looking at the cash flows for the first 9 months of 2021, they had 24 billions from operating cash flows, minus 20 billions in investment cash flows, and minus 2 billions in financing. So quite a good cash flow from my point of view. What's also striking, and it's also related to this trading gas, is that 7.5 billions were from so minus 7.5 billions from this investment cash flow were related to the trading assets. So yeah, it's the same idea. They are involved in something which I don't understand. It has nothing to do with their core business. Their current liabilities are 30 billions and current assets are 61 billion. So if we talked about the gearing, so the relation or leverage, the relation between equity and debt, we are also looking at little bit of liquidity. Since they have more than 200% coverage of their current liabilities with current assets, I think they also have a solid position, meaning that they can pay their current liabilities without any troubles. Then if you are looking at the share price and investors ratios, so there are some minor differences between these two tables. One is from eToro, the other one is from Google Finances, but they are not that significant. The share price is currently more positioned toward the lowest value in the 52 weeks range. So you see 48.89, the 52 weeks range is between 45.20 to 68.42. So I would say that it's very well positioned for buying. Of course, this is no financial advice for you. You do as you please. I'm not a financial advisor, and I don't consider myself responsible for any decision that you take in this regard, buying or selling shares and so on and so forth. What is also very interesting is that they have a very low P/E ratio for a tech company, below 10. As I have said, there are some minor differences, but let's just say that this is from the time difference when I took the snapshots and the platforms and so on and so forth. So the dividend yield 2.84%, beta 1.19, so they are basically moving with the market in the past 5 years. Unfortunately, the one year total return is not positive, but the beta shows that, okay, they have potential of delivering. If the market is growing, they will also grow, and a little bit more than the market is growing. However, if you are looking on the 5 year price chart, you will see that the price evolution was not very decisive or not very conclusive. The current price, let's say that it's quite close to the lowest of not only 52 weeks range, but of the past, so since 2018, so let's say not past 5 years, but of the past 4 years. And if you take that into consideration, that's also a recommendation normally to say that you may be in a good place to buy these shares, because they are quite cheap. So once again, P/E ratio is quite reduced, the price related to the 52-week average is quite reduced. The price related to the last 4 years is also quite reduced. They are investing a lot. So somehow I don't see them as quite the underdog that everybody is describing. I know that currently, related, if we benchmark them against the other two, Samsung, but especially TSMC, the company doesn't look very good, but I have good expectations about them because they are investing. And that's the key. That was it for today about Intel. I hope you liked the presentation. Of course, if something changes about this company in the near future, although I'm not a short-term investor, and probably I will do an update and tell you more about it if we get some news. In the news there are always let's say articles about this investments in new factories. They are not the only ones investing, the other ones are also investing, which is good for the sector. And just as I have said, let's say that I'm not extremely happy about this investment that I did, but I think it's an okay approach. It was an okay approach to invest in all of these three companies, but also in ASML. If you would like to support me, you can subscribe to my channel, hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my site. I do them quite regularly these days, on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays. Also, don't forget to like this video if you liked it, to comment if you have something to add in the comment sections below. Also, to share it with somebody that might be interested about this specific company, Intel, but also about the semiconductor sector, so the processor sector. Also below this video you have links. You can create an eToro account and trade there without a commission or a fee, which of course is a saving for you no matter how often you are trading. You can buy their shares, for example, Intel or any other company you wish to invest in. Also, there is a wish list below with software and hardware items which can help me improve the quality of my videos, thus being also beneficial for you because you'll get better videos on my side. But let's say that this is the most inconvenient way through which you can support me. The easiest way through which you can support me remains, of course, subscribing to my channel, hitting the bell notification button, and to continue to watch my videos. I hope they are interesting. I thank you for your time and patience today. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. Thank you for being here on my YouTube Finance and Accounting Education channel, and I look forward to presenting to you with the next opportunity. Goodbye!